Amen.
He got up.
Yeah.
Yes. Right? Yes.
The grave couldn't hold him. He got. Yeah. Yeah. He thought he had it. He got up. Guess what? In the same way that Satan thought he had Jesus. And Jesus got up. There's somebody listening to me right now. Satan thought he had you. But that wasn't how your story ended. You could have died in your sin, but that's not how your story ended. He should have kept you in the world while he had you in the world, but he messed around and let you get in Jesus' hand. And now that you're in Jesus' hand, there's not a devil in hell that can pluck you out. But it all started because his story didn't end. And why did he do it? Because he loved us. The songwriter said, oh, how he loves you and me. He gave his life. Yes. What more could he give? Yes. Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves me. Right. Oh, how he loves you and me.
Yes.
On this 10th Communion Sunday of 2024. Seems like only yesterday I was saying it was the first Sunday of September, but we are here again to remember the sacrifice that Jesus made so that we might be able to live eternally.
Yes.
It's a good thing to be found in the house of the Lord.
Yes.
We're grateful for those of you worshiping here in the sanctuary as well as those who are joining us online. We thank God for each and every one of you and pray that he is continuing to shower his richest blessings upon you. As always, we acknowledge we don't own the rights to any of the music that we will be sharing in this morning's worship, but we thank God for those who have shared their gifts with the kingdom so that we might worship with them in spirit and in truth.
Yes.
On this Lord's Day, on this Communion Sunday, shall we stand together? Those of you who have a program, you will find the words of our opening song printed on your program. Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood of Christ. Glory to his name.
Love.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I don't know about you, but I'm glad to be back in the house.
Amen.
Just the reason today will come from Matthew, the 22nd chapter, we're going to begin at the 36th verse. Then coming Jesus of them unto a place called Gethsemane, and said unto the disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. For he took them with him, Jesus, and the sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. They said unto him, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch for me. And they went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh unto the disciples and finding them asleep, saying unto Peter, what could he not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that he enter. Not unto temptation, he is willing, for the flesh is weak. He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, O my Father, this cup may not pass away from me except I drink it. Thy will be done. But he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy, and he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. I read in Matthew 26, chapter 36, 36, 46 words. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading, the hearing, and the news of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
Awareness month is October, and I'm asking that we paint the church pink and wear pink on the third Sunday of this month. I'm looking forward to seeing you all on Saturday. Have a great rest of your day on purpose, and God bless.
We will celebrate our church anniversary on October 27th at 2:30 p.m. Our guest speaker will be Pastor Terrence Webb, New Kingdom Missionary Baptist Church. May the abundance of the love of Christ fill all the days of your life. Everybody have a blessed birthday, for those of you who have birthdays during the month of October. Happy anniversary. May God's love continue to shine upon your marriage, filling your heart with peace and joy. Happy anniversary to all celebrating an anniversary during the month of October.
Bessie Fisher Cookie flashback moment when Sister Tamika said that her mother's birthday is in October. Those of us who were in Good Hope back in the day, we remember. Amen. That's everybody. Okay. Well, we're so glad again to have everyone joining us in worship today. Those who are part of the Good Hope family, those who are visiting, those who are watching online, we are grateful to God for each and every one of you. Do you ever just sometimes feel a sense that God is up to something? It may just be for me right now, but I'm feeling something in my spirit that's making it a little difficult for me to move on, because I don't want to get ahead of the Holy Ghost.
All right.
I do believe that the Lord wants to do a new thing in us, with us, through us. So I encourage you to keep your eyes, your physical as well as your spiritual eyes open for what God's next assignment is in your life. We are less than a month away from election. I dare not tell you how to vote. but I would encourage you to vote. I believe there may be a few days left if you are not registered yet. The time is running out. If you're not registered yet, I got my driver's license renewal in the mail yesterday, and in there was a voter registration form, but praise God, I'm already registered. Regardless of the outcome of November 5th, we must remember who's in charge. My trust cannot be in Trump. My trust cannot be in Kamala. My trust,
that's right,
must be in the Lord. The Bible lets us know it's better to put our trust in the Lord than to put our confidence in man. So I believe, no matter what the outcome is on November 5th, God's children are going to be all right.
That's right. That's right.
Because we are in His hands.
Yes.
Let us pray for the city of Pineville. Let us pray for our city officials in the city of Pineville.
Yes.
Not going into any more detail, those of you who are aware, but we need to be prayerful.
Yes.
Not only for the city of Pineville, but the Bible instructs us that we are to pray for all of those who are in authority.
Yes.
The enemy is out to steal, kill, and destroy. Don't get mad at him. He's doing what he designed to do. But what are we doing? Are we doing what we're designed to do? Are we doing what we're created to do?
Yeah.
It's giving time.
Amen.
Yeah.
The envelope that I hold in my hand says, freely you have received, freely give. Can you imagine if Jesus had charged us for Calvary? I had a debt I could not pay. He paid a debt he did not owe. The free gift of salvation. Salvation is free, but it wasn't cheap.
Mm-hmm.
As we celebrate the Lord's table today, Jesus paid it all. All to Him we owe.
Right.
But that's why I encourage us during our time of giving, that we give unto the Lord, that we reflect on what the Lord has given us. We lift our offerings up to the Lord, and lift our hands in praise unto the Lord. Let us ask His blessing upon this time of giving. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful.
Thank you, Lord.
For all that you have done. For what you're doing right now.
Right now.
What you yet shall do.
Yes.
Father, now as we come to this point where we worship you with our giving, Father,
yes,
we ask your blessings upon,
please, Lord,
this part of our worship, Lord God, that you will bless each gift, that you will bless each giver.
Yes.
Bless those who have a desire to give,
yes,
that don't have it.
Please, please, Lord.
Father God,
yes.
Let those of us who are blessed realize that we are blessed to be a blessing to someone.
Someone.
Father God, we pray that you will consecrate the hands that shall administer these gifts, that they may be used for your kingdom and for your glory.
Yes.
Which we acknowledge all the honor, glory, and praise belongs to
all
you.
All of
course, in Jesus' name. Jesus.
Jesus.
And the people of God said,
Amen.
Thank you. job. Great job.
How precious.
Precious.
Is the blood.
Woo.
Of the Lamb that was slain.
Yes.
From the foundation of the world.
Yes, yes.
I'm thankful to each of you who make up this assembly.
Amen.
On today. On this morning, I invite your attention to Acts chapter 20. We will begin our reading at verse number 28. Acts chapter 20, beginning at verse number 28. I'll be reading from the King James Version. Take heed therefore unto yourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And to all the flock, over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers.
Yes.
To feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his own blood, that precious blood that the choir was just singing about.
Yeah.
Verse 29 says, for I know this, this is Paul speaking, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Verse 30 says, also of your own self shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. Therefore watch, and remember that by the space of 3 years, I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. NIV says, keep watch over yourselves.
Yeah.
And all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Our message for this morning is watch out.
Watch out.
You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Watch out.
Bill.
In addition to October being Breast Cancer Awareness Month, October is also Clergy Appreciation Month.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you. So I was led to share during this Clergy Appreciation Month of what the clergy should do to be appreciated. Six years ago today, on October 6, 2018, we celebrated my installation service as pastor of this church. While I was excited about the opportunity to serve as pastor, I was also aware of the great responsibility that comes with that opportunity. In the time that has passed since that event, I have become even more aware of that responsibility. In the text today, Paul is giving his farewell speech to the elders of the church at Ephesus. He summoned them together to let them know that that was going to be the last time that they would see him face to face. But before he left, he wanted to remind them.
Come on.
Of some things.
Yeah.
He wanted to remind the elders of the church. Nope, he's talking to the elders of the church.
Leaders.
Mm-hmm. He reminded them how he ministered to them, teaching them how to receive forgiveness from God for their sins by placing their faith not in cost, not in themselves, but in the sacrifice that was made by Jesus Christ.
Yes, yes.
Himself.
Yes.
Now as he's preparing to go off the scene, now as he's ready to be ultimately imprisoned and put to death, he tells them that they must follow his example as they assume the leadership of the church. The elders, the leaders of the church, must focus their attention on the ministry and on their church. Ephesus was a place that was filled with idols, demons, and witchcraft, identified by temples of false gods such as Artemis. To be successful in Ephesus, there were people who felt that they needed to conform to the worldly standards of the theology of their day because they made business connections while making sacrifices to
Y'all
have to excuse me. You know how it is when you have something prepared and then the Lord just starts to open up
some
more stuff even as you're yet speaking. Aren't there people today who will basically sell their soul
to the devil? Las Vegas.
To make connections.
Yes, indeed.
The elders needed to reject that.
Yeah.
The elders needed to reject the standards of the lives that they were living before they were in Christ and to live their lives for Christ. And in the process of leading others, they needed to take their roles seriously.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
So the first thing we see in the text is the watch. Paul tells these elders, keep watch over yourselves and all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Now check out what Paul said. Before he told them to watch the flock.
Check yourself. Check yourself.
He said, watch yourselves. In other words.
That's good, Pastor.
How are you going to lead?
Come on.
And tell folk what to do.
Come on.
If you're not doing what you're telling other folk to do, the first thing you need to do before you try to make sure that those who are in your care are right with God, the first thing you need to do, elder, the first thing you need to do, pastor, the first thing you need to do, deacon, the first thing you need to do, choirman, you need to make sure that you are right yourself. Don't think because you're in a position of authority that you're exempt from the attacks of the devil. Let me make it real for you. When you're in a position of authority, you're on the front line of the attack of the devil. So we as leaders need to keep watch. First and foremost, over ourselves. You know how it is when those of you who've been on an airplane and they're doing the pre-flight instructions.
Yeah.
And they say, in the event that there should be a drop in cabin pressure, oxygen mask will fall down from the ceiling. First, place the mask on yourself and then help.
Come on, Pastor.
We got too many folks trying to help other folks when they don't. Watch out.
It's good.
It starts in the mirror.
Yeah.
I know Paul was talking to the elders, the leaders in Ephesus, but this applies to all of us. Yeah. We need to watch. Oh, well, how did Jesus say it? Get the beam out of your own eye so that you can see clearly to get the speck out of somebody else's eye. You can't go around trying to fix other folk and act like everybody.
Put it
Watch.
That's some powerful words.
Y'all have to give me. This is personal for me.
Take your time. Take your time.
The Holy Ghost has been dealing with me.
Me too, Pastor.
He's telling me that I need to check myself. I can't expect the congregation to follow me if I'm not following Jesus. I need.
That's right.
He says, keep watch over yourselves. And then he says, and all the flock. All the flock. He says, watch over the flock.
Good and bad.
The sheep. Watch over the flock. Watch over the flock. Be on guard for the herd. You know, goats running herds.
Yeah, that's right. That's good.
Be on guard for the pack, because wolves run in packs.
Oh yeah.
Paul needs us to know that when you come among the congregation, you're gonna have some sheep.
Yes.
You're gonna have some goats.
Come on, Pastor.
You're gonna have some wolves. So the leaders have a responsibility to protect the sheep from the goats and the wolves. And then Paul says, of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Overseers from the Greek root word episkopos, from which we get the word episcopate. An Episcopalian church is one that is governed by a single pastor or priest. An Episcopalian denomination has a single bishop over several churches, and so on, with a single leader over the entire denomination, such as the Catholic Church. In the early church, pastor, overseer, bishop, elder, usually referred to any of the elders over a local church, including the foremost elder, who was the senior pastor. So he's referring to these people who God has placed in leadership. The flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseer. Now, we live in a democracy. We're used to voting. We're used to choosing. But according to the Word of God, if somebody's going to be placed in a position of leadership in the church,
the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit. Mess around and get somebody in leadership.
That's right.
Who wasn't placed.
That's right. That's right.
The Holy Spirit has a part in it. Now let's look at what happened in Acts chapter 13. In Acts chapter 13, verses 1 to 3. Now in the church in Antioch, there were prophets and teachers. Barnabas, Simeon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Phinehas, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. Verse 2 says, while they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, not while they were having
a feast,
not while they were having a pulpit committee meeting, not while they were having a church conference, while they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them Paul. So notice the process for Paul, Saul, and Barnabas being sent. The leaders, the elders, they got together and they worshiped God. They got together and they fasted. They got together and they prayed. And when they placed themselves in a position to hear from God, then the Holy Spirit told them who to select.
That's good. That's good.
The way things work in the world today, your man puts you in. And again, I'm extending this beyond just the leadership. If man puts you in a position, then man can take you out of that position. But if the Lord puts you in a position, there is no man who can take you out of the position. If the Lord puts you in, then the Lord is the only one who can take you out. Oh, when you get into a position, make sure it's the position that the Holy Spirit has placed. So we see the watch. The elders are exhorted to watch over themselves and over the flock which the Holy Spirit has made them overseers. And after the watch, we see the work. In the second part of verse 28, he tells the elders to be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. Oh, there's so much right there in that part of the verse.
Yeah.
In Jeremiah chapter 3 and verse 15, the Lord said, I will give you shepherds after my own heart who will lead you with knowledge and understanding. Mm-hmm. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 2 and 3, Peter says, be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care.
Yeah.
Watching over them, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock.
All right. Yeah.
So in other words, the first thing we have to see is that the church does not belong to us.
That's right. That's right.
It's interesting. Before service this morning, I was over in the fellowship hall, and some of the young people had come in. And one of them asked the question, does this church belong to you? And I know you're not supposed to answer a question with a question, but I answered the question with a question. Well, who do you think? That no, this church doesn't belong to me. Who do you think the church belongs to? And her answer was, God.
All right. That's good.
Sometimes we get it twisted and we think the church belongs to us. It's ours to do with what we want. But no, my brother, no, my sister, if you didn't shed every drop of your blood for the church, then the church does not belong to you. Because Jesus Christ purchased the church. The church belongs to God. The elders belong to God. The under-shepherds belong to God. You belong to God. Everything belongs
to God. That's right.
Now remember, in Acts we said, Paul told the elders to watch themselves. Mm-hmm. Verse 3 of Peter says, not lording it over those who are entrusted to you, but being example to the flock.
Yeah.
Leaders can't have an attitude of do as I say.
All right.
And not as I do. As a leader, leaders have responsibility to lead by example.
Yeah.
You know how some people are, I can show you better than I can tell you. If you're going to be a Holy Ghost-filled leader who's following Jesus Christ, then you need to understand the best way to get a certain behavior out of the people who are following you is to model that behavior in front of them. I can't ask you to be committed if I'm not committed. I can't ask you to show up if I don't show up. I can't ask you to be faithful if I'm not faithful. I can't ask you to live right.
That's right.
Again, I know that Paul is talking to the elders of the church, but we're able to get in on this conversation to understand that there's a responsibility that comes with leadership.
Yeah.
I believe there's a saying that says, heavy is the head that wears the crown. We want to have the rights of leadership, but we don't want to have the responsibility. So we see the watch. Watch yourselves and the flock. We see the work that the shepherds are called to do, to feed, to lead the flock. But then Paul gives a warning. Paul says, I know that after I leave, savage wolves will come in among
savage.
You and will not spare the flock. Even from your own number, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after them. Jesus gave a similar warning in Matthew chapter 7 and verse number 15. He said, watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothes, but inwardly they are ferocious. Wolves.
Ferocious.
Paul said, after I leave, you know how it is. Paul, the leader, Paul, the one who planted the church, once he goes off the scene, then I'm sure he anticipated that there would be a power struggle.
That's right.
Paul said that there would be external forces that would attack the church. He said, after I leave, savage wolves will come in. So the fact that they're coming in order for them to come in, they first have to be outside. Yeah. There are folk who are outside who will come in.
All right.
Okay, can I get personal for a minute? There are folk from the outside who will come to you and talk about what's going on in Good Hope. What they heard,
right,
was going on in Good Hope. And they're trying to pick off certain people to separate them from the fellowship. Savage wolves, hungry wolves, they're going trying to stir stuff up.
Yeah.
Outside agitators. Paul says, watch out for them. They're coming. But then in verse 30, he says,
come on.
Not only do you have to deal with issues from the outside.
Was already in there. Come on, Pastor.
In verse 30, he says, even from your own number, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after them. Sometimes it's an inside job.
Come on.
Jesus understood inside job.
Yes, he did.
He chose 12.
Yeah.
But he recognized that was the 12 he chose. He said, one of you has a devil. Sometimes we have to fight what's going on the inside. And those who are in leadership positions have to be watchful over what's going on the inside. And when stuff rises up on the inside, then as leaders, we have a responsibility to deal with those who are trying to draw away.
That's power right there. That's power.
Draw away disciples for them.
That's power.
Listen, I'm not trying to make any Lewis disciples. God didn't call me here to make Lewis disciples. He called me here to make disciples of Jesus Christ. Yes, follow the leader, but follow me as I follow Christ. If I'm leading you away from Jesus Christ, then you need to go in another direction. But some folks feel it's more important that you follow. Now, let me put it this way. Let me go ahead and get this out of the way so we can get too close. If something happens and there's a conflict in the congregation, then I need to try to get as many people on my side.
Clicks. Clicks.
I'm not worried about who's on my side. I want to know who's on the Lord's side. And if everybody would focus on being on the Lord's side, then we wouldn't have to worry about picking sides. We don't have to worry about which clique we're going to hang out with. We don't have to worry about which side of the church we're going to sit on, because a certain person is sitting on the other side of the church. But there are folks who will come in, and one of the things that God hates is people that sow discord among the brethren. But even though God hates it, how many of you know that there are folk who will sow discord among the brethren? But those of us who are in leadership positions, when we see somebody sowing discord, we have a responsibility. Watch. Told the elders, watch yourselves and all the flock over which the Holy Spirit has made you. He said to feed the flock, to shepherd the flock, to lead the flock, to lead by example. And then he warns them and us that not everybody in the house is of the household of faith.
Goddamn.
So we have to be on guard.
Oh, yeah.
My brothers and my sisters, we have to watch out.
Watch out.
In these last and evil days, we have to watch out.
Yes.
That's right.
So in closing, in verse 28, Paul reminded the Ephesian elders that God bought the church with his
own
blood.
Yeah.
We must all remember that we are not our own. We must all remember that the church does not belong to us. That's why when people say something about my church, I don't have a church. I shepherd a church. I pastor a church, but I don't own a church. Good hope belongs to God, not to me. It belongs to the one who knows how to handle it. So, we belong to God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20, Paul says, do you not know that your bodies are temple of the Holy Spirit?
That's right.
Did I hear that this morning, bro?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Getting my notes in Sunday school. Okay. Your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have received from God. You are not your own. Verse 20 says, you were bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. If I might just recap what I heard in Sunday school. Not just in here.
Come on.
Honor God with your body out there. Not just in the church house, honor God at your house. Not just in the church house, honor God on your job. Not just in the holy places, Pastor Clyde Murphy says. Don't just honor him. from the top of my head to the soles of my feet, I belong to God. So I must be watchful of how I let the world influence me. And today, as we celebrate the Lord's Supper, remember the price that God paid for His church.
His church.
He paid the price
Lord.
With the blood of Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Jesus.
Through His sacrificial death.
Thank you,
Lord. On Calvary. And if we understand truly the value of that sacrifice, we will watch out.
Watch out.
Not only the elders, but all of us will take heed to ourselves. All of us will operate in the gift, the anointing that the Holy Spirit has given to us. And all of us will be mindful of the warning that not everybody who comes to the church house is coming for the same reason.
That's right. That's right.
Someone who has not acknowledged Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life. Every one of us here today can admit that we have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And the Bible lets us know because of that sin, the wages of sin is death. But there's another side to that. But the gift of God is everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Well, how do I get that everlasting life? Jesus said, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Paul said it this way: if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved. Peter said it this way: repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. If that is you today, you need to come, confess your sins to Jesus Christ. Let Him know that you're sorry for your sins, like David was in the Sunday school lesson today. Will you come today? Not to give your life to good hope, not to give your life to the pastor, but to give your life to Jesus Christ. Admit you're a sinner. Believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross and rose on the third day. Confess your sin to Him and confess Him as Lord and Savior of your life. And then be baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus, you shall be saved. Secondly, if you're here today and you're looking for a church home and the Spirit of God has impressed upon your heart to become part of the Good Hope family, I invite you to come. If the Holy Spirit isn't leading you here, don't come. Would I love to have more people in the pews? Of course I would. But I heard somebody say, I would rather have a people full of church than a church full of people. So if you're looking for a church home, if you're looking for a perfect church, don't come here. We're not a perfect church. If you're looking for a perfect pastor, don't come here. I'm not a perfect pastor. But if you're looking for people who are being perfected,
mature, growing in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. People who praise, worship, and serve a perfect God, then come here. And the Holy Spirit gives you unction. Lastly, if you're in need of prayer this morning, and you just need someone to agree with you on in your situation, I invite you to come. As the songwriter said, just as I am. That's an issue that some people have. They don't want to come as they are. But we can't fix ourselves. Only the Lord can fix us. So come as you are, but be different under the power of the Holy Spirit. Experience like David did, then react like David did. When Nathan pointed out David's fault, David repented and he asked the Lord to clean him up. And it was interesting what David said. He said, God, against you and you only have I sinned. We might feel kind of all right about doing something to our brother and our sister because they deserve it, and I'm not. But does God deserve it? After everything that he did by having Jesus to shed his blood on Calvary, does he deserve it? I think not. But the beauty of it is that blood that was shed will cover what you've done. So the examination is not to determine whether or not I should partake. The examination is to make sure that I partake in the right way. And if there's anything that I need to get right with God, and the Holy Spirit is bringing it to me right now, give it to us. The blood covers. Thank God for the blood. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this time that we have set aside to, in a tangible way, remember.
Yes.
The sacrifice of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ on Calvary.
Yes.
We thank you for his sacrifice. We thank you for all that he endured for our sins. Father God, we ask now that you will bless the bread and bless the cup which represent our Lord and Savior's body and blood which were broken and shed for us.
Yes.
Father, if there's anything that will cause us to eat or drink in an unworthy manner, we give it to you right now, Father.
Yes, Lord.
so that we might be able to partake and remember with a clear conscience. Oh, how good you've been to us.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, how precious is your blood that was shed.
Thank you, Lord.
We thank you. We praise you. We magnify you. We adore you. We love you.
Yes, Lord.
We ask it all in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
And the people of God said,
Amen. Amen. After the same manner, when the supper was ended, he took the cup, and when he had blessed it, he said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which shall be shed for many for the remission of sin. I will not drink the fruit of the vine with you again until I drink with you anew in my Father's kingdom. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." Let us drink together. After the supper was ended, they sung a hymn, and they went out unto the Mount of Olives. So let us depart to serve the Lord. God bless you. Amen.
Thank you.